Good evening. Welcome to the Northampton City Council meeting of October 1st, 2015. I'm City Council President Bill Dwight. I will be presiding. As is our custom, we invite the public to come speak during the public comment period, and you are not constrained by topic, nor do you even have to be a Northampton resident. What we do ask is that you keep your remarks under 3 minutes when you step up. Please identify yourself and your address, and then also please respect the decorum of the chamber, which I know, looking at us, you might say, what decorum? But what I'm saying is that an attitude of respect is what we ask, and I appreciate that. And first up, we have signed up Ella Smolensky.
Ella Smolensky, 41 Alamo Court, Florence. Good evening, Mr. Mayor, City Councilors, and Northampton residents. I hope that you had the opportunity to listen to the Pope address Congress. He reminds us about the golden rule, the environment, and the importance of the family role in our country, which also applies to us as a city. I'm a member of the National Alliance of Mental Illness of Western Massachusetts. Our mission is to provide education, advocacy, support, and encourage brain research. We serve Hamden, Hampshire, and Franklin County with 21 affiliates. I'm proud to stand before you tonight and tell you that NAMI Massachusetts was selected as the best NAMI program in the United States at the National Convention in June. To learn more about NAMI, please visit nami.org. Currently, our evidence-based free family-to-family course is taking place at Cooley Dickinson Hospital. It will teach family what mental illness is all about, how it impacts decision-making and behavior. It is not a character flaw. We also teach the skills that are necessary to relate more effectively, like how to do problem-solving and communication. Many families also share with us that their loved one may be using, there may be substance abuse involved. NAMI believes that both of these conditions must be treated to move someone toward recovery. Michelle Obama says it best. She says, mental health is just as vital as our physical health, so it's time that we get started and treat it that way. President Obama issued the first Mental Health Awareness Proclamation that proclaims May as Mental Health Awareness Month. Starting October 4th, NAMI will observe Mental Illness Awareness Week, as first proclaimed by Congress in 1990. We will participate in the Starlight Walk tomorrow. I hope I see you all there. It starts at 6 o'clock. We have been on the streets with the Iris Project, educating the public. A NAMI basic course for families with young children will start on October 27th in Springfield. Our In Our Own Voice presenters are out with a message of hope and recovery. Our CEO's Against Stigma campaign has been launched thanks to Martha Coakley's grant through Martha Coakley. The CEOs will pledge to fight stigma and promote mental health wellness. Every Thursday, Cooley Dickinson is providing a free support group led by Bruce Bradley Gilbert, starting at 5:15 on the second floor, for families affected by mental illness and substance abuse. A community conversation will take place on October 15th at Cooley Dickinson Hospital, provided by Mass General. It will be from 6 to 7 p.m. in the Dankin Conference Room. Dr. Schlotzman from Mass General and Dr. Helper and the Medical Director of the Behavioral Health Unit at Cooley Dickinson will be leading the conversation. The event is free. I know you'll all be busy that night, but I wanted to welcome the public to attend. Special thanks to the Northampton Police Department. You have no idea they're on the front lines. They're doing terrific work in the city, and they all are trained in crisis intervention training. Emergency responders, clinicians, homeless shelter workers and volunteers, churches in our cities, and of course the survival center. They're all doing very important work. And I would be remiss not to mention Northampton CTV, Community Television, for the work they do to educate our community by providing education to their viewers. Thanks to you for all that you do. Thank you.
That's very impressive, Ella. Thank you very much. You did that in 3 minutes. That's really very good. Bobby McGovern, please.
Councilors, Mr. Mayor, I wasn't going to come here tonight.
Bob, I'm sorry. Could you identify yourself and
your
address?
Yeah, I'm Bob McGovern from Package Restaurant, and I've been here for, well, this November's 38 years doing business in the city. I've had the pleasure of working with five mayors, starting with Buzz Chapman, David, Sandy, Mary, and Mary Claire, David. It was always a great place to work, and lately it's not. The union problem at the Hotel Northampton, I was outraged to see councilors, including you, Bill, Mr. O'Donnell, marching against a guy, man, that's worked his butt off. And for no reason at all. He didn't come out of his office. Bill was there, you were there. If he came out of his office, not a lot of people know that as soon as he came out of his office and spoke one word, he recognized the union and he was in the union. Not a lot of people know that. Now, there are unions that are good and there are unions that are bad. Unions have had their place, and there are some restaurant unions that I know that are good and some that are just scammers. And we have a group that comes out of Boston that comes up here, plants people in the hotel, and then berates Mansour for hiring a consulting firm to better educate his employees. And that is BS, I'm telling you. If I was the mayor in this city,
and I'm not, sir,
I would want your resignations. This was just a blindside to a guy who's given so much. And the rest of the councilors who sat by and said nothing, everybody has their reasons. But this was not the way to treat, you know, one of the best business people in the city. I appreciate your time, and I hope I don't have to come back again.
Thank you very much. Dave Herships.
Good evening, councilors, Mr. Mayor. My name is David Herships. I live at 22 Warburton Way and in Northampton, and I'm here tonight on behalf of the Friends of the Upper Roberts Meadow Reservoir and Dam. And currently, there's a proposal by the Department of Public Works to have the dam removed, and that could cost in excess of $2 million. And tonight, my colleague Wayne Thibault, who is here, and I propose that there are, and he will go into this in more detail, there are ways to basically save the dam and the reservoir, and the city would not have to spend the $2 million. Let me just give you a little bit of background. The dam was built, the Upper Roberts Meadow Dam, first of all, is on Chesterfield Road, and we're going to submit something in writing because some of you haven't been there. And are not queer. It's near the West Hampton border, and it's a very lovely scenic part, and probably one of the most visible and lovely parts of Northampton. Basically, the dam was built in 1883, following the collapse of the Williamsburg Dam in 1874, causing much loss of life and property. It was nationally a real national tragedy. So when they built the dam in 1883, they over-engineered it, and the dam is still standing today. Nonetheless, in 2007, and the dam has not been maintained. By the way, the purpose of the dam was to basically be the city's main reservoir, and which it served until the early 1900s, and the middle reservoir was constructed at the time. Currently, this is now the backup water supply for the city of Northampton, along with the wells nearby. As it now stands, in 2007, the dam was characterized by the Office of Dam Safety, the Massachusetts Office of Dam Safety, as a high hazard dam, and the city had to take some action. Specifically, the problem was that the Department of Public Works hired the GZA consulting firm, and they determined that if the dam failed, the release of the water in the reservoir behind it would cause a catastrophic failure of the, I don't have much time here, it would basically cause the middle dam to fail, inundating Leeds and creating cascade effect on the entire, down the length of the Mill River, causing much life, loss of life and property. That is not the case. Our study shows that the water, if there was there's basically the sediment in the reservoir now that is about roughly half of the amount of water has been displaced by sediment that has been deposited there over the years, and that would only basically create an inch and a quarter in the floodplain between the dam and the middle reservoir. We'll follow up and with this in writing. As you can see, there's a lot of numbers and a lot of information. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So Wayne Thibault. Yep.
Good evening, councilors, mayor. My name's Wayne Thibault. I live at Chesterfield Road in Florence. I'm a member of the Friends of the Upper Roberts Meadow Dam. I would like to give some background information on the Upper Roberts Meadow Dam. In October 2005, there was an article in the Daily Hampshire Gazette that stated, according to Ned Huntley, a Springfield firm, Bay State Environmental, inspected the dam on a Friday morning and was concerned with what thought might be a bulge. The team called the State's Department of Conservation and Recreation, which had a second team from Parsons Brinkerhoff in Boston, to come to Northampton and inspect the dam that afternoon. The group found that the construction of the old gatehouse at the dam makes it appear that there is a bulge, but there isn't one. Ned Huntley said today, I think they left feeling comfortable. It didn't appear to be an intermittent hazard, he said. The dam leaks and has for years because it is made of rock blocks and not concrete, but the dam joints are tight, Huntley said. And the inspectors from Parsons Brinkerhoff found that the rock blocks appear to be structurally sound and stable, according to Ned. He said the DPW will discuss what, if anything, to do for the dam, but he said the department believes the dam is sound. Then in 2006, GZA was hired by the city to evaluate and inspect seven of the 19 dams owned by the city. On June 8, 2007, GZA reported that the Upper Roberts Meadow Dam was in poor condition. As a result of the poor condition rating, the Department of Conservation and Recreation Office of Dam Safety issued a certificate of noncompliance and a dam safety order to the city. On September 7, 2007, GZA performed a bathymetric survey profile on the Upper Roberts Meadow Pond. The results indicated approximately 5.5 million gallons of silt and 6.6 million gallons of water. It is now 2015 and there have been two major hurricanes and substantial storms which have deposited significant amounts of sediment in the reservoir. The dam is acting as a silt trap, collecting most of the silt before it flows into the middle reservoir. The collecting of this silt has made the island above the South Pond grow in size, and a new island is forming on the west side of the reservoir, resulting in less water capacity. If a new bathymetric survey was performed since the last one 8 years ago, it could possibly show that the water capacity has diminished to 5 million gallons or less. This could result in the Office of Dam Safety no longer having jurisdiction, which in turn would allow the city to let it silt in and not have the burden of the cost of taking it down and the environmental issues associated with the removal. Time's up already.
It does go fast. Thank you, Mr. Thibault. Roger Saloon, please.
Good evening. I am sad and surprised and upset that I have to speak in front of the city council of what's now my hometown. I've been here 35 years. I own some property on Center Court and have spent enormous amounts of money to upgrade that property. It was a dangerous blight on the city, and we fixed it up. I feel it is unfair to tax one resident one way and another resident another way. The same basic tax rate, but don't supply the same services. Imagine standing on Center Court and seeing a plow truck after a storm drive down Center Street, but not come in and plow your street. The city did plow Center Court for years. And through a technicality, the city has decided to convert many private streets to city streets. Okay, let's go with that. What is a city street? Okay, what is a city street? Well, have you ever seen Carey Street? It's soon to be adopted as a city street. It is 11 feet wide It has no sidewalks, no curbs. Cars cannot pass each other on Carey Street. Carey Street is 13 feet. Massasoit Ave is 11 feet wide. That is a city street. At its most narrow, Center Court is 18 feet wide, and cars pass all the time. It's been around for 100 years, and there have been 50 to 100 people generally that go down there every day, residents and mostly medical staff. There's a couple doctors down there, a lot of psychotherapists, a couple people with disabilities. So what is a city street? I think it's an arbitrary decision the BPW made and the DPW is making. It's just not fair. You can't tax people taxes, you can't charge them water sewer fees, and you can't charge them water flood runoff fees. I think that's the name of it. And not provide services. Does the police department go down to Center Court? You bet they do. Does the fire department go down there? You bet they do. Does the DPW go down? No. DPW should not determine, they can make recommendations, but they should not determine policy. It should be determined by the citizens and the representatives of those citizens. So I think it's an arbitrary designation. What is a city street? What isn't a city street? And I think it's unfair. I know that four good city councilors voted to make Center Court a city street. I think it's the right thing to do. I want to thank them for doing that. If the city does take Center Court as a street, just leave it as it is. It's been there 100 years, and those people are paying taxes, and they deserve to be respected. Thank you for listening to me.
Thank you very much. Jasper Lopdien.
Well, I don't have anything.
And Jasper, I'm sorry, could you identify yourself and your address?
I'm Jasper Lapiensky. I live at 43 West Street, and I'm not going to continue on the policy bandwagon so much. What I want to talk about is criminal justice. Don't worry, that's nothing to do with me. But I recently learned that a friend of mine from high school is potentially facing 2.5 years in prison because she stole some food because she was hungry. I have to stop and think if I actually said that right, because it makes so little sense to me. I don't feel particularly moved to go into a long debate about it because there's nobody listening who doesn't agree with me on the point. What I would suggest is that while the city government of Northampton broadly, executive and legislative branches have no authority in sentencing, the city and particularly the mayor and the police department do have some authority in police discretion, which is a way to fight judicial injustice. Don't arrest someone for a victimless crime just because you can. I don't know if that's what happened. I wasn't there. But I guarantee it happens often. I guarantee it will continue to happen under our new police chief unless we decide as a community, as community leaders, that it isn't necessary, it isn't helpful, and we don't want it to happen. That's all for now.
Thank you very much. That's all we have signed up. Is anyone interested, anyone else interested in speaking? Just step up and identify yourself, and you got 3 minutes.
I'm Douglas Ross. I am a fellow commissioner of the Human Rights Commission, and I'm speaking as a private citizen tonight. The reason that I've been brought up here to speak to you all tonight is because a horrible tragedy has happened in the state of Oregon. Many people have been hurt and killed in the institution of learning, and it's very sad. I feel that something needs to be done to prevent this from happening in the city of Northampton. I work at a preschool as an assistant preschool teacher at Naugatuck Community School, and we have 50 to 75 kids come there every day. I am afraid that we are unprepared to deal with that type of situation if it ever arises. And I urge all of my city councilors and school committee members and everyone in the government and the police department to start looking at this issue very seriously, look at their procedures on how to handle the situation, and try to prevent it from happening here. Because I don't want to wake up at 7 o'clock in the morning when I'm going to work or when I'm going out to take a jog or when I'm going to hang out with my friends or whatever, and see that several children or several community college kids have been killed in a mass shooting. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else? Oh.
Well, hi, Joseph Masterka, 312 Chesterfield Road. I wasn't going to speak tonight before the council, but I'm going to finish Wayne Thiebault's statement when he ran out of time. I'm starting where he left off. GZA's current application suggests that the city flush the silt into the middle reservoir. An article from the Gazette dated September 14, 1976, titled Erosion, Siltation of Streams, Eyed as a Result of Lowering Upper Reservoir, states, Chairman of the Conservation Commission, Richard Carnes, said the commission's main concern was stabilization of the reservoir banks to prevent unnecessary erosion. Lowering the water would expose the banks and rains would continue to erode the soil. Commission member Obie Hubley added that a good deal of silt had accumulated behind the upper reservoir dam. When the water is released, the silt will go with it, he said. Excess silt would be deposited in the connecting stream, the middle reservoir, and water further downstream, such as Paradise Pond and Smith College. Carnes later explained that excessive silt would degrade the quality of water, decrease the varying capacity of the middle reservoir, and adversely affect the wildlife along stream bottom and banks. If we don't handle the silt problem at the reservoir, we will pass the responsibility on to someone else, Carnes said. We would like the councilors, next paragraph, we would like the councilors to insist that a new bathymetric study be done to determine the actual amount of water behind the dam. If the capacity is approximately 5 million gallons or less, then the Office of Dam Safety could reduce the hazardous classification. We would also request that you reject the application of flushing the silt down the middle reservoir. Thank you. And that's the end of Wayne Thiebault's statement. And I would just like to add that having read the current proposal by the Department of Public Works, it is to take the dam down by layers, block by block, and to let the silt run down the channel between the two reservoirs into the middle reservoir. And they're estimating that there's 27,000 cubic yards of silt in the impounded area of the reservoir now, and that 10,000 cubic acres, plus or minus, would go downstream and end up in the middle reservoir. And just coincidentally, we're talking about the Conservation Commission in 1976. I happen to have been on the Conservation Commission then. And I just want you to visualize 10,000 cubic yards. That is 1,000 dump trucks lined up, dumping full loads into the middle reservoir. It'd probably take weeks to do it with 1,000 dump trucks. And that is the present plan. And I hope you find it as unacceptable as I do. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else?
Hello, I'm Lily Gave. I live at 608 West Hampton Road in Florence. I also own property in Center Court. I own two buildings in Center Court. I support my friend, neighbor, and colleague, Roger Saloom's statement. Also want to thank the city council members who did support converting Center Court to a city street. What I'd like to add is offense I took at a city planning meeting when the members were going through the names of streets to be considered, and someone said in front of all of us publicly, oh, Center Court, that's just a parking lot. And I've continued to hear that bandied about, and I take a lot of offense to that. It's zoned commercial. It's downtown central business. There are businesses there. There are over 100 pedestrians who come and do business there, and people make their income and pay taxes on their income there, as well as the taxes that come from ownership of the properties. There was a great irony 7 years ago when one of my buildings was hit by lightning and burnt. I had the opportunity, and thank God no one was hurt, had the opportunity to bring it up to optimal code, including access ramps and first floor accessibility with widened doors and bathrooms. But when a colleague of mine was interested in renting an office, this person was blind, to utilize those advantages, I discouraged her because I worried about what might happen if she tripped and the myriad of gaping potholes and the ice that is there because of the neglect. I've, from time to time, in my 20 years of owning property there, have made repairs to areas that didn't belong to me, and I was warned by other owners' attorneys that I might be accused of trespassing, but I couldn't get those people to join me in maintaining the street. It's a city street. It's downtown business. Business is being conducted there, and I ask for your respect and consideration. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else like to speak at this time? Then I'm going to ask the administrative assistant to call the roll, please.
Councilor Adams.
Here.
Councilor Dwight.
Here.
Councilor Klein.
Here.
Councilor LaBarge.
Present.
Councilor Murphy.
Here.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Here.
Councilor Sherrill.
Here.
We have a quorum, and we may convene. Before we start business, I'd ask everyone to take a moment and give a moment of silence of reflection for the passing of John Musanti, former financial director here for the city of Northampton, and most recently the town manager for Amherst. And actually, I'm sure if you've read the paper or followed any of this, the accolades can only be gilded at this point. His loss is obviously huge and significant to his family, but the two communities that he served is also, we've also reeling from this. So if you would please just a few moments of reflection of a good man and good service. Thank you very much. First up, I have an announcement of a public hearing. This is regarding the City of Northampton's tax classification for real and personal property. A public hearing will be held to discuss the percentages of the local tax levy to be borne by each class of real and personal property within the City of Northampton for FY 2016, and that's in accordance with Chapter 40, Section 56 of the Mass General Laws. So the date, October 15th, 2015, here in these chambers at 7:05. And the public is welcome to participate in discussing. What we usually discuss in these hearings is essentially what's known, Northampton abides by what's known as the factor of one, which means commercial properties and personal properties are all taxed at the same level. And then there are a number of other alternatives or other communities, for instance, that tax commercial property more heavily. Depending on their influence. So if anyone in the public has any ideas or notions relative to that, please come and participate in that hearing. Now we come to communications from the mayor. Your Honor.
Good evening, councilors. I have a few communications this evening. First, I wanted to make an announcement on behalf of Northampton Community Television. to invite the public to join them for the inaugural Northampton Film Festival, which will be celebrating the cinematic arts on the weekend of October 9th through the 11th. This is the first year that NCTV is hosting this festival, along with Forbes Library and the Northampton Arts Council, and all screenings will take place at the Academy of Music. So wanted to bring that to your attention. Secondly, speaking of arts, I have a proclamation that I'm issuing this week, and it is timed, well, you'll hear how it's timed. It's American Craft Week, October 2nd through 11th, 2015. Whereas every day, thousands of American artists share their vision and talent by producing amazing, handmade, decorative, and functional objects, and then displaying, promoting, and selling them. And whereas American craft enriches our homes, wardrobes, offices, and public spaces, it contributes to our nation's economy, our balance of trade, and the fabric of our national history, especially with a renewed emphasis on American-made goods. It is original, beautiful, and enduring. Whereas now in its sixth year, American Craft Week is the premier public celebration of handmade craft in America. And whereas Northampton has a long history of supporting the arts and is home to the Paradise City Arts Festival of Fine and Functional Art, which is an official supporter of American Craft Week, and whereas the City of Northampton wishes to promote the Paradise City Arts Festival as the perfect travel destination during American Craft Week and the peak of fall foliage season, now therefore I, Mayor David J. Narkowitz, do hereby proclaim October 2nd through the 11th to be American Craft Week in the City of Northampton, and I ask all citizens to join me in publicizing, educating, displaying, and enjoying the wonders of American craftsmanship. And obviously, we have the Paradise City Arts Festival, which will be coming up, and so this is timed as part of that. I have one more communication before I move on to the presentation. And that is, I know some of you were at last night's SDAT report out session. That was the AIA Sustainable Design Assessment Team, who were here for 72 hours, helping us with our planning in terms of combating the effects of greenhouse gases and planning for climate change. And so one of the recommendations that came out of that was a recommendation that I, as mayor of the city, join the Compact of Mayors, which is a worldwide compact of mayors who are committing themselves and their communities to reducing greenhouse gas emissions and preparing for the impacts of climate change. I wanted to announce that I have done that today. So I have a copy of communication that I've made to the Compact of Mayors, so we have signed on. We've been part of similar initiatives over the last several decades. This is a new one, and given all the work that we are doing and plan to do, it seemed appropriate for us to sign on to that. So that's one other point of information, and I can give you copies of this later. Okay. So the other report that I'm preparing to give you tonight, you may recall that during my FY 2016 budget message, you can go ahead and distribute, I outlined the need for us to take a look, explore all new revenue options, and in particular to take a look at the option of payment in lieu of taxes or pilot. And I also pledged in that budget message that by on or before October 1st, I would present to you a proposal for such a program. So tonight I am presenting you with a copy of a proposal, and I'm going to just quickly do a quick overview of it for you to sort of highlight what's in it, and then talk about what the next steps will be. This is me, okay. I have a little magic mouse here, apparently. So again, I'll go to the first slide. So, first of all, as the report covers, we did a pretty extensive review of what is our tax-exempt property in Northampton, taking a look at all the value of all of our properties. 22.37% of the total value of all of our property is tax-exempt. Northampton, if you take a look at the ranking of the 351 cities and towns in terms of the amount of property value that is exempt, we rank 16th. If you take a look at cities in Massachusetts, And I would note that we are ranked in terms of our population, we are ranked 38th in population as a city. But in terms of tax-exempt property, we rank fifth among cities, behind Worcester, Cambridge, Chelsea, and Boston. So those are some interesting statistics, and I think they set sort of the backdrop for why it's important for Northampton, which is not located in, you know, the eastern part of the state, why we have a unique set of circumstances that I think makes it imperative that we take a look at a pilot program. Here's the list. Again, this is put out by the DOR. This just kind of shows you. Interestingly, there are a few communities in their small towns that, which I think are there largely because they have a large amount of state forest. New Salem, for example, has an incredible amount of state forest land, and some of the other smaller towns that are on that list. But you can see Northampton highlighted. This is a map of our city, and all of the shaded areas shows you that the all the areas that are tax exempt, and you can see that of the total acreage of our city, some 29.63% or almost 30% is owned by some tax exempt institution or another. Now, why is it important? I said, as I outlined in our budget message, why it's important that we do this, why we look for new revenue. Again, 22.37% of our total value is classified as tax exempt. That means that the remaining 77 plus percent of taxpayers are responsible for funding the city services. And as we all know, 80% of those are residential taxpayers. I mentioned in my budget address that our reliance on property tax has grown exponentially over time. As state aid and other revenues have dried up, we've had to rely more and more and more on property tax. And again, we are under that 2.5 cap. So in FY 1991, that was 25 fiscal year budgets ago, 26.42% of our revenue was from state aid. And in FY 2015, it's 15.12%. In that same 25-year-ago budget, we relied on property taxes for 38.33% of our revenue. In the most recent FY 2015 budget that closed out, 46.81% of our budget relied on property tax. So you can see sort of almost an inverse, as aid went away, we've had to rely more and more on property taxes. And again, that becomes compounded when we have such a high percentage of tax-exempt property owners. This is just showing you the chart, showing you, on the far left is FY 1991. You can see the tax percentage going up and up and up, and you can see the smaller bar, which is the percentage of state aid, having some cycles, but essentially never keeping pace and heading downward. So what are the types of tax-exempt land that we have in Northampton? Obviously government, our own local government. We've got county and regional. We've got state and federal. We've got some quasi-governmental. We've got private educational, religious, hospital, charitable, recreation, museums, cemeteries. It's a range. This is a breakdown of the land uses in Northampton by percentage. And all of these charts are in this, so you can refer to them later. I'll just go through them quickly. This just gives you a breakdown: private educational, 46%, municipal, 24%, and then it gives you all the various breakdowns from there. The top 10 owners of tax-exempt property in Northampton by value: Smith College, City of Northampton, Commonwealth of Massachusetts, United States of America, that would be the Veterans Administration, the Housing Authority, Cooley Dickinson, and you can see the rest of the list. These are the top 10 owners by acreage. Obviously, we have the most in terms of acreage. Audubon is next, and then you see the rest that follow down the list. Pilot defined. So payment in lieu of taxes or pilot is a formalized way for municipalities to request tax-like payments from tax-exempt property owners in recognition of the local services from which tax-exempt institutions benefit. common elements. We've done a lot of research on pilot agreements and pilot programs. Typically, they focus on the largest private tax-exempt institutions. Participation is obviously voluntary because obviously they are tax-exempt. They are exempt from property taxes under state law. And so it's voluntary, and when done, it's generally tied to some recognition of municipal services that the community provides. Many programs offer credit for community services and in-kind contributions provided by the tax-exempt institutions. Typically, most pilots exempt government, which have their own rules and regulations, religious, conservation, and cemeteries. They can be individual agreements, ad hoc agreements with individual institutions, or there are communities that have formalized pilot programs for all or you know, uniform guidelines for how a pilot program works. Currently in Northampton, as I highlighted in my FY16 budget message, we have these pilots that are listed, and we received in FY15, we received $192,000, a little over almost $193,000 in pilot. This is all detailed in the report, but we have a pilot with the Housing Authority. Housing authorities under Mass General Law have certain formulas based on their number of housing units, and they pay pilot to the communities that they operate in based on that. Smith College has a current pilot, which is part of the development agreement that was negotiated by Mayor Higgins. It's focused primarily on properties that are taken off the tax rolls, and this was obviously related to the construction of Ford Hall and some of the other acquisitions that took place in the Green Street and West Street area, as well as Belmont. And so the way that pilot works is that if and when Smith College tears down or takes a building off of the tax rolls, they've agreed to compensate us for what sort of a fixed value of what the taxes would have been if they stayed on the tax roll. I would add that as they take other properties off the tax rolls, for example, if they sell a property, they get a credit against that. So it sort of is there's a mix between properties coming on and off. We have a small pilot agreement with Congregation B'nai Israel. As the council knows, it's long, as some councilors know, and even more recently, it's long been the policy of the city council when we sell land or property, city property, we typically, especially buildings which have developable value, we generally include some kind of a pilot requirement. You may recall we just recently, a couple of years ago, sold the Florence Grammar School. And one of the requirements in the RFP was that if it was a tax-exempt owner that was going to purchase it, they would need to negotiate a pilot with the city. The same thing occurred when the city sold a parcel of land next to the water department to CBI. Part of the stipulation of the council order that surplused it was that there would have to be a pilot that would replace some approximation of what the developable value of the property was. So we have a small pilot with them as a condition of that sale. The other ones are federal U.S. Fish and Wildlife. As you can see, it's a massive $552 in FY15. We have an agreement with East Hampton for some property that they have that's in Northampton, water shed-related land that's in Northampton. And then we have some state-owned land that, again, we receive a pilot reimbursement that comes to us as a state revenue under a formula that's in state law. That's not really negotiable, and I know you'll be shocked to learn that the legislature traditionally underfunds that pilot account. So it doesn't affect us very much, but I know that our neighbors to the west, who have a lot of state land, often feel the impact of pilot not being fully funded. Think, you know, Zor and the Charlemonts and the Rose and the, you know, places like that that have large tracts of state forest. As I mentioned in my budget message, Steve Kulik, who is the ranking member, the vice chair of the House Ways and Means Committee, introduced a bill this year, H.R. 2584, which is an act relative to payments in lieu of taxation by organizations exempt from property tax. It would basically require a local option acceptance, so cities and towns would have to accept it. It would allow a municipality to implement a program for pilot to the municipality. The payments could be equivalent to 25% of the amount the organization would have been assessed on real and personal property if it were not exempt from taxation. And it could also include exemptions for community benefits. And this bill, as I alluded to in my budget message, was largely based on the successful City of Boston program, which they'd had pilot in some form since the 80s, but really in 2010, the late Mayor Menino implemented a fairly new and sweeping program that has been looked at by a lot of folks around the country, including this mayor. And they basically set up this system where they took a look at all their assessed properties. They came up with this 25% formula. Now, the 25% formula is what they regard as that portion of a municipal budget which is really focused on core services: police, fire, emergency rescue, public works, you know, plowing, roads, all those kinds of things. And so that's how they came up with the 25% figure. They also set limits on who would be assessed under the pilot. They exempted the first $15 million worth of property value. And they primarily focused on colleges and universities, hospitals, and cultural institutions. And as you can see, the last fiscal year, 2015, they received $25.9 million in voluntary cash pilot payments from those institutions.
Mark, may I ask a question? Does Boston enjoy exemption from the Dover Amendment?
They enjoy it by virtue that Boston predates all laws in the Commonwealth. So Boston's pretty much exempt from all Mass General laws in one way or another because they were here before they were created. But
God,
yes,
but
they do. They do,
so they
but they also
that we wouldn't otherwise have.
Well, they have it. Cambridge also has it, has an exemption. But yeah, they have it. But again, I think the way Boston focused on this program was really, you know, in looking at it collaboratively, trying to work with the institutions collaboratively, and that was really the approach they took. Again, keeping in mind it's voluntary. They also one aspect of it is up to half of the payment is allowed to be in kind in terms of so benefits that they're already providing, services that they're already providing, get credit toward their payment. You'll see a picture there, Payments in Lieu of Taxes, the Boston Experience. This is actually a quite good article that was done by the Lincoln Institute, which is a land policy think tank that does a lot of work in this area around property and taxation. We've actually got that article linked on our website so people can read it, but it really gives you a good overview of what happened in Boston. So when we turn to look at our properties and we look at how, you know, in trying to put together a program, we take a look at how are our tax-exempt properties valued. The valuations are typically done for all of our property using the proprietary software that the assessors have. It's approved by the state. The values relative to land are determined by a land value schedule that's particular to that neighborhood based on land sales and other things like that. Buildings are a little bit more challenging. The software uses basically building square footage, construction and condition minus depreciation. Obviously, one of the things it doesn't have that you know, commercial and taxable buildings tend to have is it doesn't have comparable sales data. You know, museums and libraries don't sell very often, and nor do college buildings. So that is one of the areas that we will need to address as we move forward, because these numbers are, again, based on a very formulaic review based on the software, and that is one of the aspects of the Boston program where there was an exchange of information around to try to better determine what those values were in cases where they felt that it was not accurate. Cost of municipal services. So we took a look at what are our core municipal services? What are public safety? What are public works?
What does that account for in terms of our municipal budget? Looking at that 25% number that that Steve Kulik's bill and the Boston program uses. When you look at all those factors, and I want to be clear, we are putting all these factors in. We are not including enterprise fund. We are not including any public works related enterprise fund activities, water, sewer, stormwater, solid waste, because obviously those are paid by user fees and tax exempt institutions do not pay them. So 25.36% of our general fund appropriation went to all of these core areas. So we feel confident that the 25% number that's been applied in other programs fits with our Northampton model as well.
Did you say they don't pay them? They do pay.
They do pay them.
Yes. Okay.
They do pay the fees. They're not exempt from the fees.
Not exempt from.
Yeah. So they do have to pay those fees. So we would not want to then, you know, include services that they're already paying for. That's correct. So what are the exemptions that we've looked at in our program? We are exempting federal, state, regional, and city government properties, churches and cemeteries, and conservation land. Those are the ones, again, very common. The governmental ones for statutory and reasons. And then the other feature of the program that I'm proposing is that we would exempt the first $1 million of value. Again, the goal is, you know, we have many smaller institutions, and so we wanted to really look at who could afford, who had the means and capabilities. So we're using this exemption of $1 million exemption. So only the value after $1 million would be part of this pilot program that we'd be looking at. So this is a list of all the tax exempt property then that would be included in the pilot program. And you can basically see it in ascending order of value. It's actually two pages, so I'll just click. To go back, is it right click? Previous, okay. I just wanted to show you that it's a two pager. So this basically shows you the owners, it shows you the valuations, and then basically we do, in this column, we do the $1 million exemption, which basically basically focuses on the 10 largest tax-exempt property owners in Northampton. The cutoff, you can see it's, you know, it goes from 800 up all the way up to 1.2 million. So after exempting the first million, these other organizations that are here lower down the list, all the way down to Pioneer Habitat for Humanity, would not be part of the program because of the size of their value. Community services credit. The program that I've presented to you would include a community services credit. We want to recognize, and we do recognize and are appreciative of the many contributions that our tax-exempt institutions make in the community that benefit Northampton residents directly. And so we would also include a 50% credit applied against annual pilot payments for those direct community services. And again, stressing that they must directly benefit City of Northampton residents, somehow support the city's mission and priorities, or offer ways for the city and tax-exempt institution to collaborate to meet shared goals. Obviously, they'd need to be quantifiable, documented, and differentiated from broader economic or employment benefits. Not, you know, we hire X number of people, those kinds of things, but actually quantifiable direct benefits to the city. And we would, each year, as we sought these voluntary payments, institutions could submit to us a list of the types of community services that they provide. And again, I want to stress, most of our nonprofits are already doing this, and so it would be a matter of quantifying those types of benefits that they're providing. Because this would be a brand new program, I would propose that it be phased in. Many of these institutions are nonprofits. They have, budget. They have a budget process like we have. So to go from basically no pilot to a pilot in 1 year may create may create disruption in terms of their budget. So we would propose to phase it in over 3 years. So you can see in the middle column, and I also want to back up with the caveat that we're using the current tax rate, $15.80. We don't know what the next tax rate will be. That hasn't been set yet. We obviously don't know what the FY 17 or 18 or 19 tax rate will be. So these numbers are really, we're just applying them for purposes of demonstration, and we're applying the current $15.80 valuation. So you see that the pilot payment at 25%, this would be the total pilot payment that would be requested as a voluntary payment. But then for FY 17, which would be the first year that this would be implemented, next fiscal year, we would only be asking for 1/3 of that. It would then grow to 67.3% in the second year, and then in the third year, 100%. Again, keeping in mind that the number that you see on the screen would be also subject to half of that number being eligible for credit for community services. So again, these are the 10 institutions that are over that $1 million of value that would be part of this program. So what are the next steps? I pledge that I would bring back to you a program, but I do feel like this is, and I talk about it in the report, that you know this is really the start of a conversation, and I really want to get this report to you, get it out to the public, and allow you to review it, allow the public to review it, and to really get some feedback. So I am going to file a resolution later in the month. Asking the City Council to consider endorsing the proposal. Obviously, we're not adopting an ordinance. We're not allowed to adopt an ordinance around something like this. It's a voluntary program. But I really feel it's important to have the City Council's support and endorsement of such a program. So I would be putting forth a resolution seeking your endorsement. I would not be bringing it forward till November 19th, which would be after this 45-day period. I am going to schedule 3 town hall meetings to present this information and present more of the information in the report to the public. We've scheduled them in Northampton, Leeds, and Florence, a series of Wednesdays over the next 3 weeks. And then I've reached out today. I've sent all this information to the leaders of the tax-exempt institutions, and I'm going to be setting up meetings with them to discuss the program and to get their feedback and their concerns. And so my hope is that through this combination of the council reviewing it, obviously hoping the citizens will take a look at it, and also meeting with the tax-exempt institutions, that we can try to move forward with implementing some kind of a program. Again, voluntary, but I do feel, given the fiscal constraints that we are facing, given the fact that we have gone to the voters, asked them to pass an override as part of a multi-year fiscal sustainability plan, and also pledging to them that we're going to seek every form of new revenue, I believe it's incumbent upon us, given the metrics of our city, that we should make this approach and do it in a very formalized way and in a very organized way. And I hope that the program that I've developed does that. I also just want to finally point out that we have set up a special web page on our website. It's northamptonma.gov/pilot. And you can find a copy of the report. You can find other information, media stories. You can also find that Lincoln Institute study that was presented on the Boston Experience. So that's the presentation that I have for now. I can take questions, and we can move on with the meeting.
I just want to, it's not so much a question, to reemphasize the volunteer aspect. So what happens is that we enter into an agreement with any of these agencies who are willing to abide by it. We have nothing to hold over any agency that refuses to abide by it or come to agreement. It's essentially us going hat in hand, but in a fair way, I think, at least this presentation seems fair. So just so the community understands that we do not have the power or the authority to actually impose this on anyone. We can may only request it. Is that correct?
Until House Bill 25 right. Was adopted, then we could
We would have that power, but obviously we don't now. So yes, you're correct. And I don't actually, just one thing I would say is that the program would be sort of the agreement, would be sort of that would be the outline. And we would make a request on an annual basis. So there would not actually be a negotiated agreement. We would have a program. This is our program. We would explain it. We would update it. We would try to communicate with all of the institutions on an annual basis. If you go to the Boston website, Boston has a pilot, a pretty comprehensive site. You can see year by year. You can even look and see, what Mass General or whatever institution filed in terms of their community credits. You can pull up their sheet that shows all the things that they submitted for community credit that year. You can see what they paid. So we want to be transparent. We want to make sure that this is all out there for people. And obviously, we're trying to approach this in a collaborative way. We do feel that, the city does provide these core services to these, large institutions. Fire, police, plowing, all those sorts of things, streetlights, you name it. And so we do feel that it's fair to have this conversation.
I just have a question on the valuations. So these are based on property values, right? The valuations that are down here?
They're based on a combination of whatever it is, land and building valuation. As I said early in the just like your own tax bill, where you get one for your land, one for your building. The land we feel fairly confident about. The building is one that will probably need more refinement, because again, we don't generally go through a huge assessment process because we're not taxing these buildings.
The one that just jumped out at me is it says Clark School for the Deaf Ears, actually now Clark School for Hearing and Speech. I mean, we know they sold off a lot of their buildings, but they still retain a fairly large building and a lot of land, and
yep.
The valuation here is $18,480.
Yeah, that's a good question. We'll have to look into that and see what that's about. I'm not really sure. Yeah, we can definitely check that. That's straight from the assessor's database. But we can certainly look into that and review it.
Didn't historically, I remember the assessor and Council Murphy can probably update me on that, but the assessor really didn't, since there was no purpose necessarily in assessing the value, they really just kind of picked a number out of the air.
Yeah, no, actually, we were concerned about that, and we have checked. I mean, the company that helps us with our revals does look at some of the factors. They look at square footage of the building. They do try to approximate construction costs, and they also try to use an age approximation. So they do put in some of the things that they know, but obviously they're not, they don't have the comp for one, and they also, because they're not sending a tax bill, there's not any, it's not like, and also like, for personal property tax, they're not sending an inventory of what equipment's in the building because they're not being taxed. So I don't want to say that it's just a number picked out of the air, because it is a number based on some of the metrics that we know about the building. But definitely one of the aspects of the Boston program, for example, was working with those institutions to actually try to bring those, seeking information from them to update that information. So we would have to do that.
And however, for instance, Smith has a projected building cost of a new library of $100 million, so the assessment would be pretty easy from that. At least for the valuation on that particular building.
Well, that's true. Although they are renovating an existing building, so I don't know how that would factor in.
It's not a ground up.
So I don't know how that would work. But that would be one of the conversations we would have to have, and that's again one of the conversations that Boston began to have with some of its largest, hospitals, universities. So that would be definitely a component of the. Again, I want to just. All these numbers, the tax rate is based on a static tax rate because we don't know what the tax rates are going to be in the future years. And obviously the numbers we're using are taken right from the assessor database. But at least I think they give us some guidance as to what the parameters would be.
And should these come to fruition, would the pilot actually impact the tax rate? That's assessed.
No, it's not. No,
so they're completely
separate
files.
Tax rate. It's a voluntary payment.
Got it. Okay.
It's a gift. Yeah, doesn't have any impact. That land is still for assessing purposes and for valuation purposes. It's exempt.
Councilor LaBarge and then Councilor Adams.
Thank you. Mayor, I want to thank you for doing this presentation this evening. And I know myself as a counselor, I've come in to see you a year and a half ago about pilot programs, and another college I had talked to you about how they did the process of the pilot program, which was not an easy one. And I want to thank you, Mayor, for doing what needs to be done. And it's a lot of work. It's not an easy job. And I know with the three meetings that you are scheduling here, will counselors and the public automatically have updates? Say you're working with a Cooley Dick. Will we have a follow-up about how you're doing?
I will certainly, I think once we get past this sort of 45-day kind of public review period, and again, I want the council to give me its feeling about whether this is a good thing for us to pursue. And then I would begin working with them. And again, we'll try to provide all the information that we can provide about what's happening. And again, I've already reached out and sent copies of this earlier today to those largest institutions that are identified, so they would have a heads up. And a lot of them know that I've been working on it, because you may recall back in May when the budget message came out, this was a little bit of a story that people were talking about. So people have known, and I said October 1st, and it's October 1st, so here we are. So, I'm trying to make sure that I'm communicating with them and giving them advance information.
I, too, I think at the beginning of the term met with you and another concerned citizen.
Yep.
And many other people have asked you to do this. I appreciate it.
Definitely.
Quick question. Can you remind me why churches would be exempt?
Why which?
Churches.
As I look across other programs, churches, synagogues, cemeteries are generally not part of this program. And I think, that's the approach we took. The Boston program exempts them. They are in a different charitable classification than other large institutions that have a tax exemption. Those are the things that I can certainly hear about during the next 45 days of how people feel about that.
Yeah, I appreciate that. I would request that we reconsider that. We saw Congregation B'nai Israel is voluntarily doing a pilot. And
they're actually not voluntarily doing it. It's a condition of the
sale. By contract, okay.
It was a condition of the sale that we wouldn't sell them the property, and they're only doing a pilot on a lot that's a
condition of the sale.
No, it's actually where you see the garden next to the water department. It's they sort of bought it as buffer land because it was available land. The city was going to sell it, and I think they purchased. Yes, Councilor. I thought you were going to add something to that. I'm sorry.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm going to let him finish his question.
Okay, first.
I hope that we take a look at that and really consider whether or not any religious institution should be exempt. Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, they're unique because they're exempt from zoning ordinances. Mm-hmm. You can put a church wherever you want to put a church. There, you can't zone them, and it's a use exemption. And that's something the Roman Catholic bishops around the Commonwealth had discovered. If you don't conduct services in them, they become taxable. Just because it looks like a church and you call it a church, it's not exempt. If
and
you don't actually call services
in them. We have sent tax bills to some of our churches.
The ones, St. Mary's Church is closed. That's taxable. Mm-hmm. St. John's Church is closed. That's taxable. So if they really do close them, they lose their exemption. So there is a mechanism that if they're not actually holding services there and using them for religious purposes, they come back on the tax rolls. So you've got to actually use them.
First of all, I think the methodology you've laid out is very orderly and logical, and so I appreciate that and commend you for that as a way of approaching this. But on that point, certain numbers, recognizing that this is all voluntary, the $1 million figure, for example, it seems like it's good policy to draw some line, like you did at $1 million. I guess my question is that a number that you've seen used in one of the other communities in the Commonwealth?
Boston used 15 million, but they have much higher values and much bigger institutions. So they used 15 million, which still captured almost 50 property owners. Obviously, if we applied 15 million here, it would be a small list of one. And so we were trying to balance, look at the list, you know, look and look at some of the smaller organizations that tended to be smaller social service organizations, the Safe Passages that were on the smaller end of the spectrum. And so we chose a million as a cutoff. It's a common in tax law. It's a, you know, we have a ballot question we're looking at in terms of, you know, our state income tax. So it seemed like a logical number.
And just to, if I can follow up, I mean, you raised kind of the central thought that I had about it, which is, and you alluded to it a little bit in the beginning when you were prefacing this report by talking about declining state aid and the challenges we face because of an overall tax system that's not very fair. So with this, and again, it's all voluntary, and it's laid out with a methodical process, which is good, but we have, you know, historic Northampton on the list as well.
Yeah.
And I'm sure you recognize, you know, the challenges they have.
I do.
Right. And again, it's voluntary.
We also have the Arts Trust, which is essentially an open-air building right now with no walls in it, which I've talked to Richard Wagner about. They're trying to raise money to build it. But I felt like if I say, I can't put historic Northampton on, you know, I kind of had to be just objective about it.
Yeah, so, but actually, yeah. Well, and I appreciate that.
Yeah.
And actually, what I was going to say is not really a criticism in that sense. It's more, is there an opportunity in this window, this review window you've laid out, to think about other ways to assess what, you know, an organization might pay in a voluntary way, in terms of not just what the buildings are worth or might be worth, but their reserves or their income and this kind of thing. We could do it better than a normal property tax, perhaps, or substitute in lieu of a property tax. It's just a comment that, you know, it's an idea that jumped out at me looking at this list, so it might be worth exploring in some
way. It is. The only thing I would say is that, you know, part of the underpinning of a pilot is you're trying to build equity between those who are paying taxes and those who are not paying taxes, and the value of your property is sort of, that's the common. So that would be the only, that would be the only concern I'd have. And, you know, playing devil's advocate, they may say, well, you know, now you're just trying to pile on by adding other things, or I don't know. I don't know if you're trying to do that to their benefit or to, I'm not sure.
Yeah, just to establish more equity, but I mean.
True, yeah, it's possible.
I mean, I understand your point as well, so.
Councilor Klein.
I'm wondering if there are any models or if the city would consider having a component to this program that would be kind of like the good neighbor component. So that, you know, if this is voluntary and you're going to have places that maybe decide not to, and those that decide to, that there could be some kind of campaign that really reinforces the importance of this and shows that there are institutions that have chosen to take part, just to create a kind of social aspect to it so that people are getting credit, the institutions are getting credit for
that's. I think that's actually the brilliance of the Boston model, because it really created a sort of, you know, when Mayor Menino started this, some institutions were paying, some weren't. Some were feeling like, well, why are we paying when, like, that institution's not paying? And so this was kind of done across the board. It's put out every year who's paid, and there's, you know, there's a report that's issued every year. And obviously those institutions receive public credit about it. And, you know, the institutions that maybe I you know, there's obviously a natural inclination for institutions to sort of see what each other are doing. So it does kind of build that kind of, we hope it would build that sort of spirit of people wanting to join and do something. I know one of the comments I've heard as I've had conversations with one of our largest institutions was the feeling that it was always just focused on that institution, as if they were the only tax-exempt institution in town. And I think that's a common, that probably is a common thing that plays out in a lot of cities. So that is one of the, I think, the nicer things about having a sort of an objective, that we're not just asking this institution, but we're asking all institutions to participate. Again, voluntarily, and they may not, but we're definitely, we definitely want to do it in a way that's positive and that gives credit and encourages others to participate.
I guess I would just like to see that kind of written into the plan, that there's some way in which we can kind of celebrate the good neighbors who come forward and do this, so that we're doing it very consciously.
Okay.
This comes in the time, I mean, actually, I appreciate the impetus for this. We've talked often about the pressures on people on fixed incomes and the taxes that they're paying that compels some people to feel that they have to move from the community. So we lose an aging portion of the population. Then we also have the challenges that come with people trying to find affordability to live here who are younger, which maintains and builds on the vitality. It is asking of essentially, well, private nonprofit corporations to, while they give their contributions in their services, some directly, some indirectly, to the community, that all of us as citizens should participate if we appreciate the community that we live in. And I think in that, this plan and the request is in that vein. And I'm grateful for this. I think, I mean, obviously the pressures, the diminishing state aid, and without prospects of increased state aid, and even more diminishing federal aid, which their contributions were minimal to begin with, the fact is that we've continued to rely more and more on this regressive taxation system of property tax. And that's evident in that graph. It's very graphic in that as the state abdicates from its contributions and we now become reliant on property taxes, which is essentially, in my opinion anyway, an unfair system of taxation, and not based on people's ability to pay, but only based on the valuation of their homes or their property. And I hope that as you go through this process, and when it does come to you find yourself going hat in hand to the various institutions and speaking to their directors, CEOs, or presidents, that they understand that that's the intent here. This is not trying to figure out one place we can gouge somebody to cover our butts for our extravagances, but this is to actually help us all develop and prosper as a community.
I would hope Representative Kulik, if the legislature in its infinite wisdom decides to make this mandatory in the state's nonprofits, I think it's incumbent on them to honor their responsibility and actually pay their own damn pilots to all these communities that they've been stiffing, in violation of their own state law.
Yeah.
If it's good enough to hit the nonprofits, I'd like to think that they'd ante up and live up to their responsibilities. Well, it's already in law.
The magic words are always subject to appropriation.
Okay. So hopefully if they're going to sock it to the nonprofits, I hope they live up to their own responsibilities.
Like charter school reimbursement, like regional transportation reimbursement, like pilot, they're all subject to appropriation. They're not mandatory. So, and because they don't affect all communities across the Commonwealth equally, it's easy not to fully fund those. So. Yeah.
Especially the ones that are underrepresented in the
exactly. Think, yeah.
Well, the ones they can't hear scream from Boston are usually the right. ones that suffer the most.
Yes. The only other thing I would add to what you said, Council President, about that 25-year arc is what's also kind of there, but you can't see it, is that at the federal and state level, cutting a race to see who can cut taxes the most, but meanwhile shifting more and more of the burden on property taxes.
That's a magical. Three-card Monty game. The fact is when they proclaim that they've reduced taxes in the state of Massachusetts, they have not. They've just shifted the responsibility and burden on people who've been less capable of paying every time. And it's fairly cynical. It's as cynical as building a casino.
With or without a tower. Anyway, those are the next steps. I'll keep you posted. Obviously, we're putting out information on the website. We'll be publicizing the town hall meetings for people to come to, and I'll try to keep you posted between now and November 19th.
Thank you so much. And with this presentation, actually, I forgive you a PowerPoint. I mean, I normally break out in hives when PowerPoints come, but
I was going to read all 14 pages to you, but I thought it would be better to
very much appreciate that.
It. Yeah.
Thank you. Any 1-minute announcements? No 1 minute announcements. Okay. We've had our presentation for the evening. Right now, I would ask the council to move approval of the minutes for September 17th, 2015.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor of approving, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? We have committee meeting minutes from Social Services Veterans Culture Recreation. This is a meeting of July 20th, 2015. And also, we have the minutes of the Finance Committee meeting of August 25th, 2015 and September 1st, 2015. Is there a motion?
Approved.
As a group?
No.
Okay. Any discussion?
Did you mention the Public Works Committee as well? If you're taking these as a group. I heard you take the first.
Yeah, no, I don't have a list on this.
Okay.
You want?
Okay. This is the version that's on the HTML from the page. No, thank
it's
you.
It's on there.
Yes, so we'll include that as a group?
We'll include the Board of Public Works. That's it.
Okay. Yes, right. Okay. It is the. So the Public Works Committee meeting minutes of September 3rd, 2015. As well. Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion on these minutes? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? I see all second readings for financial orders. Do we have any reason to recess for finance?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We have
well,
a whole exciting agenda.
Yes, we do. I'm sorry. So we will break now for the, we'll go into recess. For the financial, the Finance Committee was chaired by Councilor Murphy.
So I'll call the meeting to order and ask Pam to read the role of Finance.
Councilor Murphy.
Here.
Councilor Adams.
Here.
Councilor Lawrence.
Present.
Councilor
Kelly. Here.
Great. The first item is to approve the minutes of this committee from September 17th. It says 2017, but I bet it means 15th.
Moved.
We're good, but we're not working in the future yet. Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Okay. Next, the financial orders. And the first one is the big upon the recommendation of the mayor, order that the Northampton City Council approves the attached credit and incentive policy for stormwater and flood control utilities for 2016 pursuant to subsection 280-10 of the Code of Ordinances. And I think everybody has in their packets two relatively large documents, and I'm very glad to see the finance director here and also several knowledgeable gentlemen from the Department of Public Works and our energy officer and the mayor. So a motion to recognize
motion to
all
recognize.
Of these, not the mayor doesn't recognize, yep. But our friends from Energy and Public Works.
Make a motion to recognize the Board of the Department of Public Works.
Second.
Favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Excellent. So I know that the DPW made a presentation to your Public Works Committee about this already. Based on the ordinance that you adopted for stormwater, we are required to bring to you on an annual basis the stormwater credit policy with any revisions. They made a recommendation to me, which I've approved, and then it comes to you for your approval. So I know Mr. Huntley and our stormwater expert, Doug McDonald, is here to talk about the credit policy. So I would yield the floor to them to give you a quick overview of changes that may have been made since the original policy. I know as we've gone through this new process, we've learned some things, we've heard some from some property owners, and we've tried to make some tweaks based on that. So I'd turn it over to
evening, everyone. I believe that you have a memo that was dated September 30th at this point. This one has four bullets, which are the four major changes. There's some wordsmithing that was involved in the policy also. Just try to tighten up the language a little bit. The first bullet talks about is for residential properties that install a drywall. For those who don't know what a drywall is, basically it's a cistern in the ground that takes in stormwater properly mostly from roof leaders or areas of land and will percolate or infiltrate it back into the ground again. We had a number of calls from residents who claimed they had those and feel it was worthy of a credit for that, which would be a small credit. Let's see, 2.2 is the section the first bullet talks about. which is, get to it. It's a 25% reduction in fee for having a dry well. The next bullet is talking about is properties that are enrolled in Chapter 61 land versus agricultural preservation or conservation restriction land. Currently, the APR program and conservation restrictions have a 50% reduction in their fee. So what's the change is that we had a lot of interest from especially farmers and people that have vast tracts of land in chapter status. Chapter status can be forestry, agricultural, and nature. And what they do is they received a reduced tax bill for that property. I believe it's 25% of the assessed value. So we looked at, they're very similar in nature. However, the Chapter 61 land can be taken out and converted back to regular land again if you pay your back taxes for 4 years and some other penalties on it. But they are similar in nature, and like I said, it really came from the farming community about this particular break. So we felt it was important to put this into it. It affects about 120 properties total, and according to the information that I received, it's probably about $4,000 worth of property for the stormwater utility, just so you're aware of that, in fees.
Just a question. So, because there's other 61 classifications other than these three, but it's only forestry, agriculture, and recreation that qualify?
That's correct. Okay. A, B, and C. Well, that's 61, 61A, and 61B.
61A and 61B. Okay, so it doesn't cover golf courses.
I didn't know golf courses were part of.
There's a there's a chapter classification for golf courses.
Under 61?
Yeah. So it's under, it would fall under that.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, Don. Yeah.
All right.
So that was the second bullet. There was a minor change in that also in under 2.5, where we found that some of the APR and conservation restriction land had buildings on them. And with that, they changed the fee so that it was the pervious portion of the property only that received that 50% credit. So they are going to get built on impervious property, buildings, and so on. The next third bullet was about best management practices. It was kind of onerous what we had done before as far as the language. We tried to make it a little bit easier for homeowners to qualify and for older subdivisions and projects to qualify for a credit. So we changed quite a bit of the language under 2.6, or 2.7, excuse me, for that. And you can see that in your redlined division edition also. And the last one is a bullet was under section 2.8. which was a credit to properties that are dedicated to stormwater management. Some of the newer subdivision that have been approved have actually lots that are defined for stormwater management purposes solely. They're owned by the homeowners association, and we felt fairly strongly about a credit being applied to them because that's what they're doing. They're managing their stormwater properly. There's not buildings, there's not extra properties really dedicated to stormwater management works.
That was something that was really important to me when you're doing this, because essentially the residents of that subdivision have already been dinged for stormwater management, mm-hmm. and they put in the systems to deal with it. So theoretically, if the engineering's right, they're not discharging any stormwater already.
That's yeah. correct.
So thank you for dealing with that.
I want to thank you for doing that also, Ned, because I know that the Department of Public Works worked very, very closely with some of my subdivisions who had great concerns about that. So I'm very happy to see that this is being worked out.
Great, thank you.
Councilor.
I support all these. I'm slightly skeptical about creating an 100% credit for any category, as I brought up.
You brought that up at the Monday meeting, yes.
Right, and the only reason why is because the task force is very, very clear that they felt that each and every property should contribute. And so creating a 100% credit actually does create a property type that doesn't contribute, but it makes sense why, mm-hmm. and it is fair, but I just want to point out that we should be careful against giving 100% credits when each and every property is supposed to be contributing.
Councilor Dowell?
Yeah, on the same subject, just a question. I mean, how do you know that a property is dedicated to this? How do I answer the question of someone who lives in the meadows, for example? You know, they say, well, we're just a field. Don't we retain stormwater? Is it there, because there's an actual process you've gone through to apply to be a stormwater mitigation property?
It's actually part of the subdivision rules and regulations, and the parcel is cut out as part of the plot plans from that. That's how they're formed. It's not just a random piece of property that someone's claiming. It's actually, it's built, it's featured to control and manage stormwater from a development.
Okay, thank you. So just to further clarify that, the houses in the subdivision get no break on their homes.
No.
But the homeowners association gets a break on that parcel of land where, say, the detention pond is, because they pay taxes on that. But that parcel is usually entirely consumed by this pond, where the water that's collected from the streets gets stuck so that it leaches into the ground. So the houses themselves don't get a break, but the piece of land owned by the homeowners where they maintain their pond is what gets the break.
Correct? That's the intent of the language. That's correct.
Thank you. Counselor, actually, Counselor, our council president has
yes. So
I'm just actually back to the issue of the meadows, of course. Now, when our stormwater system is overwhelmed, of course, we discharge into the meadows, don't we? Isn't that where the overflow would go? Would they be absorbing our, first of all, they're not necessarily protected. Well, correct me if I'm wrong, and it looks like you're about to. So I understood that they don't necessarily enjoy the stormwater protection that the rest of the city does in some respects, and that in the event of catastrophic overwhelming of the system, that the discharge is sent into the meadows to prevent flooding further upstream.
Well, that happens everywhere across the city where we have discharges that go into streams, rivers, down to the meadows. I realize the meadows is kind of a little bit different situation, the fact that the Connecticut River floods,
right,
and they get the brunt of the flooding down there too.
So the natural flooding that would occur regardless.
Right.
But they aren't subject to additional flooding that to prevent, for instance, if the pumping station can't handle the discharge and it starts backing up and we start having problems, where does that water go?
That would retain the old mill riverbed and then overflow from there into downtown if our pump station failed.
Downtown.
Right.
Okay.
We'd be trapped inside the levee system.
Because they're outside.
Right. They're outside the levee. Majority of them are outside the levee.
No, I was provided some information at one point to suggest that they were the discharge outlet with the idea being minimal impact or comparatively minimal impact relative to.
Basically, everything makes it to the Connecticut River in some way, shape, or form.
Yeah. And we, not by our leave, I suppose. Thank you, Matt.
Yes.
Okay. You all set? Also, Mark? All right. Any other questions on this one? Then I don't think we did a motion before this, so. A motion for positive recommendation to council would be in order. Anyone? Second? Any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. All right. Thank you.
Thank you for your time tonight.
Thank you. And, now we'll find out why Mr. Mason is here. This is an order pertaining to the landfill solar array project. Upon the recommendation of the mayor, whereas parcel map 42 lot 89 and 49 lot 3 constitute the former Northampton landfill and buffer land adjacent thereto, and whereas the director of the Department of Public Works and the mayor as chief executive officer have determined that the parcels are no longer needed for the landfill and landfill buffer purposes, and whereas a guiding principle of the Sustainable Northampton Plan is for the city to significantly reduce greenhouse gas emissions and increase the amount of renewable energy used throughout the community, and whereas the solar array proposed for the land on and adjacent to the Cap Glendale Road landfill would actually reduce emissions from municipal electricity consumption by 2,929 metric tons of carbon dioxide and provide 4.25 million kilowatts of clean renewable energy to the municipality, and whereas the proposed 3.3 megawatt landfill solar array will provide the city with about $9 million over 20 years in cost savings and income, and whereas the proposed solar array will significantly reduce the city's risk of spiking and fluctuating electricity prices by providing 20-year set price for net metering credits that the city will use to purchase about 40% of its electrical needs, and whereas Massachusetts' growing solar industry has created tens of thousands of jobs in the state, and the selected contractor to develop the Glendale Road site is a Massachusetts-based company, thereby continuing to grow the Massachusetts commercial clean energy sector. And whereas the proposed solar array project will include online tools and educational resources and support a demonstration photovoltaic system at the recreation buildings located at Florence Fields to promote education and understanding of solar photovoltaic within the city school system. And whereas the City of Northampton issued a request for proposal pursuant to Mass General Law Section 30B, subsection 16, real property disposition from solar energy developers, established an evaluation committee comprised of city staff with expertise in landfill operations and experience with renewable energy solutions, engaged an independent energy consultant under a grant provided by the Department of Energy Resources to support the city and facilitate the procurement, and conducted a thorough review of 12 received proposals, including interviews and reference checks of the top four ranked proposers, and determined the order of the most to least advantageous proposal to the city, and made a recommendation to the mayor. Whew. Now, therefore, it be ordered that the city hereby determines that parcel 42, lot 89 and 49 lot 3 are no longer needed for landfill and landfill buffer purposes. Transfer the care, custody, and control thereof to the mayor for the purpose of leasing the parcels, and authorizes the mayor to enter into a 20-year lease for the property to Amoresco Inc. for the installation of a solar array on such terms and conditions to be determined by the mayor. The City Council further authorizes the mayor to enter into a 20-year power purchase agreement with Amoresco on such terms and conditions determined by the mayor. And with that, the mayor.
So as you know, a week or so ago, we announced that we had selected Amoresco, a Framingham-based corporation, to who had one of the folks who bid on this project that we had gone out to an RFP. We did a neighborhood meeting earlier this week in Ward 6 at Ryan Road School. Thank you, Councilor, for helping to organize that. And so now, as promised, we're bringing forward this order on first reading that would essentially allow us to move forward to enter into the agreements that we would need to do to actually effectuate the solar project. So I've asked our city's energy and sustainability officer, Chris Mason, to just kind of walk you through the process and show you some of the facts about this particular system and answer any questions that you have. So I don't know if you recognized him in that.
Well, yeah, in the massive recognition of everybody in the back row. And while he's working his way up here, so purpose of the discussion, can we get a motion on this?
Make a motion.
Second?
Second.
Oh, Mr. Mason.
Okay, thank you very much. So the handouts I handed out are two. They're both handouts that came from the public hearing or public information session the other night. I thought they would be. You guys would find them useful, and the presentation I have here is basically just a compilation of some of those slides. I've just pulled some of those slides out. I believe there's actually additional slides up on the city's website if you wanted to look at them further. Just to kind of place this back in time where this all came from, the Sustainable Northampton Plan, I just want to mention, has got a guiding principle to significantly reduce greenhouse gas emissions and shift to renewable energy uses throughout the community. A couple years ago in 2013, you may recall the city conducted a public planning process aimed at developing a roadmap to increase our renewable energy use. Part of that process was a couple very large forums that were very well attended. And I think it's notable that of the 12 strategies that came out of that process, one of them identified was to put a PV array on the Glendale landfill. And then I must admit, independent of that, I must say that the idea of a PV array on the landfill has been mentioned to me by a couple of councilors. So it's not a new idea. But that led the city, starting last fall, to procure or actually apply for a grant to pay for an owner's agent. The city has never done this before. We only have one landfill. We probably will never do this again. So we thought it was a good idea to have someone with some experience sitting on our side of the table with us. We got a grant from the Department of Energy Resources, and in December of 2014, we contracted with Beth Greenblatt of Beacon Integrated Solutions, and we were fortunate that she was available on state contract, made it easy. We worked with Beth on our energy services performance contract of 2010, and we're really highly impressed with her. Since then, she has helped a number of communities go through this process. We were really pleased to have her on our side of the table. Just quickly, the review team for the proposals consisted of Ned Huntley, the Department of Works, the Department Director of the Department of Public Works, David Valletta, the city's engineer in charge of the landfill, David Pomerantz, Director of Central Services, and myself. Joe Cook was off, our procurement officer, was often giving us advice, and this team gave us experience and knowledge of landfill operations, renewable energy projects, public procurement, and landfill solar contracting. So we had a very nice team to look at the proposals. If we go see the second slide here, it didn't click. Let's see. Yeah, can I just, I'm sorry, go to the next slide. That was kind of showing me the, I missed one there. Okay, I won't go over all of these right here. This is, they're in the handouts. This was, Beth Greenblatt put this together. This is the, kind of going over the procurement process that we went to. I'd be happy to answer any questions. I think I can sum it up just to say that there were 12 proposals, and upon review of all of these and the process that's spelled out up there, led the team to recommending Ameresco to the mayor. Next slide. And again, I'm kind of not going to read all of these. If anybody has any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. But I do want to point out a couple of the main pieces that I feel about the a project summary here. Just to be really clear on what we asked for in proposals and what's been offered, is Ameresco will build, own, operate, manage, and ultimately decommission a PV array on the landfill. The city won't own this. The city is entering into a long-term, or at least is hoping to get approval to enter into a long-term lease of the public land and a power or a net metering purchase agreement. You'll see up there that there is a price given of around 7 cents per kilowatt hour would be the price that we would pay for the net metering credits, which essentially equates into the price we would pay for electricity. That's not, even though it has 5 decimal points up there, that's actually not possibly, but probably not the final figure, because there are a few costs that are outside of Ameresco's control and are yet to be found. So particularly the utility interconnection costs. So that price might go up and down a little bit. But it's really going to be right around that number. I think what's important, though, is that whatever number we do come up with, which is significantly lower than what we pay for electricity straight from the utilities, will be set. It will be a solid price for 20 years. It won't change. It won't go up. It won't go down. It's stable. We can plan on it, and that's one of the advantages. You'll also see up there that it says about $7.65 million in benefit to the city over 20 years. That's primarily in cost savings. So it'll be a little bit of income from the project as well. And I want to say that is an incredibly conservative number. For instance, that is based on the idea that the amount of money you're comparing this to is the current price of electricity that will never change over 20 years. Now that's, over 20 years, has anybody ever seen electricity prices not go up? I mean, they might go up and down a little bit, but over 20 years, they tend to go up. So probably a more realistic number is about $9 million in benefits to the city. It could be even higher than that. I've heard Beth mention that it might be up as high as $12 million. But that's a very, very conservative number, about a $7 million benefit to the city. Okay, next slide. Some of the benefits of choosing Ameresco, some of the things that we saw as a selection committee. First of all, we really focused largely, the process we went through had us looking at experience before we even touched on price. And we looked largely at applicants' experience we looked for a strong team, information on technical, financial, administrative, because they're going to have to be applying for permits and interconnection process, and environmental. Those are the strengths we were looking for, and the idea that it was a very strong team. A number of the proposals had multiple applicants for one proposal, and so we were looking at how tightly were they working together. Ameresco was one of the few ones that basically was going to do pretty much everything by their company. They also had identified an environmental consultant. Very important. The landfill is probably one of our most sensitive pieces of properties. We don't want to damage the cap. We want to be very secure there. We were impressed with Ameresco's team altogether. You can see up here right now, this is one of Ameresco's slides from the other night, that it is a Massachusetts-based company. And as I said the other night, they often work with local contractors. There will be a few subcontractors they will be hiring that they haven't identified yet, and they like working with local contractors. It wasn't a requirement for us, but it was definitely something that the team was looking for, something local-based. So next slide. Ameresco had a very large amount of experience installing solar. You can see by looking over that slide right there. And next slide. But in more important to us, I'd say Ameresco probably, I can say this. Of all the proposals that we received, of all 12 proposals we received, Ameresco had the most experience putting PV arrays on landfills. And not only that, there are 5 projects that they have shown right here are landfills in Massachusetts. So they have experience working with Mass DEP and putting landfills in the regulatory environment of Massachusetts. We did due diligence right down to the end. We called their references. We called up at least four of these communities up here. And uniformly, the response from the communities that worked with Ameresco in the past was positive. I would say a common comment was they did what they said they would do. That's basically the comments that we heard. There were a few cases where the projects ran into some problems, not Ameresco's fault. One had a broken cap on their landfill to start with. One of them wasn't in compliance to start with. They ended up with a finished project anyhow because Ameresco worked through those with them and did what they said they would do. I also want to add that we can really strongly anticipate a contract that works well to protect the city. As part of the process of the RFP process, Beth Greenblatt, Beacon, our owner's agent, Joe Cook, our city solicitor, Joe Cook, our procurement officer, Alan Seawald, our city solicitor, and a special counsel who, Jeff Grandchamp, with specific domain experience in this field, crafted a specimen agreement, a sample contract that was put into the RFP and that Ameresco has agreed to use as a solid starting point. We really expect the mayor is only going to have to see some very light editing of this in order to reach a final contract. In that specimen agreement, we had 100% payment and performance bonds. There was decommissioning assurance in the form of an annually renewing bond for the decommissioning, removal, and restoration of the site. So we're not going to have to worry about taking this thing off when it's done. A guarantee production provisions. So if there's a shortfall, that they will be paying us some money. Anyhow, termination payment obligations in the event of a default by Ameresco, something we truly do not expect. But in case there is, then we will get some benefit. Some of the lost benefits for the balance of the term will come to the city. Specific provisions regarding Ameresco's operation and maintenance and coordination on the site with current operations. Full insurance requirements and security provisions. And coordination with emergency procedures and coordination with public safety are all worked into the contract already. And I expect so that the mayor's got that all already laid out and ready to go. I want to go through a few more slides here just because some of these get interesting. This is what was in the proposal, so you can see how the PV array was laid out on the landfill. You'll notice that there's some little gaps in there. That's because we required them to stay away from any of the gas wellheads and the gas pipelines. Next slide. We also asked proposers to have an option to put something on the buffer land just to the south of the landfill. Ameresco proposed one of the smaller ones there, and very nicely was, I think, one of the only proposals that didn't require cutting trees. So they fitted in within the shadows, of existing shadows. Go to the next slide. This is based on their current design, and that might change because they haven't gone through interconnection yet. The utilities might require certain things. So we can't say this is locked in solid, but this is a rendering of what the solar PV project might look like if you're in a helicopter flying over it. Next slide. Another one looking from the west, how it might look. Next slide. Another one looking a little bit from the southwest. One more slide. And this is a rendering from the ground from one of the properties on the west side of the landfill, looking over at the landfill. I think that's it. Any more? Oh, I'm sorry. No, I did include four things. The project schedule, assuming we reach contract negotiation and reach a contract in October, they could have this thing up and running in May. It may take them just a few more months than that. May would be wonderful. Would help us get the first year summer, the first summer's worth of sun shining down on the array. Next slide. Some details on the overall construction duration. I'll let folks ask questions about this. This has a few points about how they're going to mount something on a landfill without penetrating the cap, how they're going to mount things on the side land, and a little bit about how they're going to get equipment in. It's a pretty low impact project altogether. Next slide. I believe this is the last slide. And just also to note that Ameresco did provide educational materials on solar that we are going to help bring to the school, to bring to the principals, the administration, the teachers, to see if it works for them to bring this in. And as part of the project, they are going to support a demonstration project that Ameresco won't build it, partly because of the way procurement works. We will use the support that they give us in order to put a demonstration project on the Florence Fields property. So the concession buildings, thank you. And that will be something educational-wise. It's right there, you know, people, the kids going out to play games, they're going to be able to see the PV array. And there will be an LCD projector that shows information about the landfill out there. So I'd be happy to take any questions. I hope I kept that to under 10 minutes.
Councilor Doyle.
Oh, yes. Oh, I guess that was in there. But no, that's actually a good point. Right, right. Let's see. Well, I could say that off the top of my head that the array will produce enough electricity to cover about 40% of the city's, of the municipal energy use. Another way of looking at that is that would cover the amount of electricity used by all of our schools and all of our administrative buildings. I'm not counting the water treatment plant. There's a couple other big users, streetlights. But it would cover about 40% of our uses. It's a 3.3 megawatt array that's DC. And that would then produce about 4.2 million kilowatt hours a year. It'll diminish a little bit over time, over 20 years, because PV arrays do tend to diminish just very slightly every year, about 0.5% a year. And that's what all of the other monetary benefits are based off of.
To that point, Chris, actually, because the state of the art, of course, isn't changing, and over the course of a 20-year contract, if the technology improves to such a point that Ameresco thinks it would actually generate more power more efficiently, would they do an install or retrofit for the project, or we just basically got the equipment we got for 20 years?
Well, if Ameresco, I mean, the contract will be based on what's put in there. I mean, PV or photovoltaics have been getting, you know, more efficient. They've actually more been getting less and less expensive than
right.
They have been more and more efficient. So I don't really foresee that happening. If it did, and Ameresco said, boy, we could make a lot more money, and you guys can make a lot more money off of this if we modified it, I would think the city would be open to, you know.
It would involve renegotiating the contract, or is it something built into it?
I would think it would, yeah. I would think it would. Right. I mean, that would be to try to build a contract off a complete unknown like that.
Right. No. I understand. I just wonder what level of flexibility was there, given that the technology is advancing on a regular basis. You're right, it gets more cheaper, not necessarily producing more power, but who knows? There's certainly people moving towards trying to design PV arrays that based on their projections will perform even greater miracles. So
right. I must say, from an environmentalist point of view, that wouldn't be a bad situation to have. You know, if all of a sudden solar just got really, really efficient and cheap, it's okay if I invested in something older.
Right. I mean, my only concern was that should there be the prospect of a benefit, we're not trapped into not realizing that benefit. That's all.
I think most contracts by mutual agreement can be modified.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks.
Yeah, but 10% of 20 years is not a bad appreciation.
Right? No. Exactly.
Council LaBarge?
Yes, thank you. Mayor, I want to thank you for telling Chris on a reminder on that 40%, because we would not have known that if we did not have that meeting. And I did get some calls with some of the residents that were there that night of concerns about the visibility of that one house in the back that abuts the landfill, of seeing the tracking. And I'd like to know, nothing's going to be done about that for him, right? Because he's going to be able to have to see that.
I mean, the only thing I could possibly think of doing would be to put a fence up, and that even would be difficult because it would be putting a fence on the landfill, and then he would be looking at a fence.
Yeah, because I think, so didn't Amoresco mention something about that? They really didn't like putting up fencing, plus we already had one around the outer edge of it.
Yeah, and the other thing I could think of, and I know this has happened with site plan review, you know, in other communities where the developer has agreed to put in buffer trees, but I know the other night he was talking about trying to clear trees out of his backyard.
Wow.
So, yeah, I wouldn't want to promise that we're going to be able to alleviate that from him. And yet, I know these pictures here show a bird's eye view from up high. I think it might be interesting to see just what does it look like from down low. The hill kind of goes up fairly steeply there.
Have you checked that out yourself, Chris, the back of his house? Because I've been there.
No, I haven't. Yeah. Yeah, so I'm not sure what to say. I can't promise anything on that.
Well, I have to say, I think they did a very well, great job.
It'll be a side profile. They'll only be seeing the side profile of the panels because they're facing south. So where his yard is located, they'll just see the side profile.
Right, because I think he also had concerns, another resident did, of the glare on that, and that was straightened out. I mean, that's what this meeting was all about.
Absolutely.
To get the abutters.
Right. That's right.
That abut that landfill, and they did come.
Right.
So I want to thank you, Chris, also, because I think Amoresco and you and the mayor did a wonderful job having that meeting.
Okay, great, yes.
And I have to say, even on the outside, going around with my flyers that the mayor's office designed, that many people are in full support of this on our ward. And I think it's valuable because it's quiet, it's clean, and it's a no-brainer.
There you go. It is quiet, it is clean, there's no water use to produce the energy.
Exactly, and our group out there always stated after we closed that landfill that hopefully we would be able to go solar, and I'm hoping that it does happen. But I think, I don't know if I had heard you state that, say at the end of the 20 years, we can say, or the mayor can say, within that 20 years of that lease being up, well, if you're still around, that we could say to them, well, we no longer want it. So it would be their responsibility to take everything down.
That's right. Right. Or renegotiate an extension.
Yes, exactly, because I think the mayor talked about that. Okay, thank you.
I don't want history to forget that it wasn't easy to get here, and that it was a battle, and that You know, there are two remaining councilors, Councilor Barge and I, who actually were on the council and voted to shut the landfill with the hope that this would happen. And there was a lot of criticism, including from the mayor who was current at that time, and some many other high-profile people in the community, who we were accused of playing politics. We were accused of throwing away a good revenue stream. And there was a lot of criticism. And as today, it may seem like a no-brainer. It was with a lot of criticism we took that vote.
Yeah.
And it was a split vote, and it wasn't easy. And so, again, today it may seem like a no-brainer, but it took a lot of courage for the council to do that vote. And here we are. And I'm very thankful because the public, many members of the public were in favor of it. Many weren't, but there was a majority of this council that decided to do it. And today we're saving money, and it's clean energy, and it seems perfect. But I just don't want us to forget how difficult it was and how we faced criticism and did the right thing. Thank you.
I'm not in a butter, but I learned a lot at the meeting this week, so thank you very much for that. And I was really impressed with the process and how you came to choose Ameresco and their presentation. I mean, when you look at that picture, I know that they, you know, this was looked at very carefully, but are we sure we're maximizing that space? I heard there's a pit there, whatever that means, so you can't obviously put PV there, but is there, we're maximizing all usable space there, you think?
On the landfill, on the top of the landfill, absolutely. And the main reason why is, you know, for one, we need to keep, the DPW really strongly wanted to have all gas pipelines, all of the gas to energy pipelines and wellheads well clear. They wanted to be able to get to them. They didn't want to have to move a PUE array if something went wrong with any of those. And then you're really limited to the flat surface on the top. So it's built on anything below 5%, which actually may be useful for the abutter to know because it won't be on the slope coming down.
5%.
It's up on the top.
But just to add to that, because basically they're sitting on concrete piers. There's concrete blocks that are sitting on top of the cap, and that's it. They're not the cap blocks aren't fastened to the ground.
Right.
So you wouldn't want them on a hill that could shift, and suddenly your array would slide off. So I think that's the reason why.
That is the reason why.
Flat space.
That is, right.
Because you can't drill down and fasten those blocks into the cap.
Right. People have put PV arrays on the slopes of landfills, but it's basically anchoring them at the bottom and put big rails up the sides, and it gets very expensive. So, and then the piece on the side out here, I will say that Ameresco limited use up that field. We believe, I'm pretty sure, the reason why, because of the size of it. It happens to be right up what will get the highest value for SREX. So I don't want to go into the whole SREX regulation, but they sized it just to be able to get that. We did have other proposals who put in more on that side. They would have proposed more. They would have filled that field up quite a bit more. They would have chopped down trees and put up more. And they would have broken it up and did kind of rather creative ways, which got rather complicated, to try to get more revenue out of that. And the city just felt much cleaner with this. So could they have maximized a little bit more? Possibly, with that lower field. But there's some big advantages to keeping it clean, simple, possibly allowing some of that other land to be developed for a few sites. City might be able to sell some of the development on the rest of that property, and no trees came down, which I think was a really important piece.
And so. I also feel that it's important because when we had that lawsuit that was occurring with the residents and the city, after we bought that property, Fedora's property, that at a meeting it was also stated that we might possibly use part of that land for building lots. And that generates some money for the city.
That's right. And I believe that'll probably still be possible. I don't want to guarantee
it. No, exactly. Because at the meetings, it did state that we had, that there was a possibility we could do that.
I also just wanted to do one more sort of
go ahead, Mayor.
Chris translation, which was, you mentioned something in all the SRECs, but isn't it true that you get better SRECs for being on a brown note.
So you get better.
So they're getting better credits for the part of the array that's on the landfill, which is diminished when you get off the landfill.
Yes.
I believe the buffer land is actually getting the same.
They are getting,
And it's just because of the way the SREC regulation and the fact that you can have a certain percentage of it off the land at a certain size.
But if you go beyond
they're getting the best benefits. They're getting the maximum benefits for all of them.
Councilor Scare, are you all set?
One quick other question. I know that it's designed to protect the cap, but if the cap were to be damaged, they're prepared to repair it. Are you able to repair a cap in a little piece, or?
I'd have to look through the contract, but I'm really quite sure we are, with insurance and stuff, we are covered for that.
Okay.
That would be one of the first things I think the DPW would want. But at the same time, we want a plan that should not damage the cap.
Right.
And this really shouldn't. It's large blocks sitting on there that are designed so that they're pounds per square inch is below, the minimum that the cap can handle. So it shouldn't be a problem. Yeah.
Has the mayor, have you looked at that agreement?
Yes, it's part of the RFP.
I thought they mentioned that at the meeting, that if anything happened, that
they
would step in.
They're required to have insurance, put up a bond. It's a $100,000 plus bond.
I just wanted to raise, so we're crystal clear, the issue of the net metering cap, which we've reached for our region. My understanding is that unless the legislature acts, it creates, we're put in disarray. I'm saving that pun up. Thank you. And so I guess my question is, when we act on this order, we're authorizing the mayor to seek a contract in terms that he finds suitable for the city. And if the net metering cap by some disaster is not raised in some form by the legislature, and we find it's, well, I guess my question is two things. Would we sign a contract anyway, even if the net metering cap were not raised? I think I know the answer to that. And second, are we, just to make clear, when we pass this order, we're not obligating that to happen because it's contingent as a second step, of course, in executing this contract. I just wanted to be clear on that.
You're authorizing the lease, and you're authorizing me to negotiate and sign a contract. Right. So that net metering credit is very high on our mind right now because they're hoping, they're saying they're going to try to get a vote on it before they all leave again for Thanksgiving in November. There's been a lot of pressure, a lot of lobbying, there's a big hearing, because every week that goes by, that federal tax credit that's only a year away gets that much closer. And this deal won't work very well if they don't get the federal tax credit. So
just to apply further pressure in the situation, I mean, if the legislature doesn't act, are the hopes for our contract and our landfill significantly diminished?
I think we'd have to revisit that issue with them and try to figure out how it could be restructured.
Okay.
We would have to look at that, most definitely. Because that's a big part of the savings that we would benefit from are those net metering credits.
Right.
That's basically how the solar industry has been built in Massachusetts, to the number one industry in the country. So that's critical. Although I will say the governor has acknowledged that he now is supportive of trying to raise the cap. The Senate already voted to raise the cap. Speakers, we're not sure what he's going to do. He's trying to deal with natural gas and all the wind and all these other things all at once. But we're trying to impress upon him, we've got to raise, we've got to just get this cap raised. So the frustrating thing is all the other Eversource, all the NSTAR, they're all below the cap. So there's still cap space for them. National Grid's the only one that's at the cap.
Right.
So, and there's a bunch of other projects that are, and I think they said the other night is all we have to do is get the cap raised. And then once we're under the cap, we're guaranteed for 20 years.
Right.
The credits are guaranteed. Even if the cap gets hit again,
okay,
we're protected. So it's going to be the next few weeks and months are going to be, that's going to be definitely on our mind. And I'm sure it'll be on Amoresco's mind.
Exactly.
Try to figure that out.
All right.
But I'm certainly not going to sign a contract that puts us at a disadvantage.
Yeah, I was just kind of wondering what we would do if the cap did not get raised, but I guess I won't even ask that question for now. Yeah.
Yeah, I do understand that the specimen agreement that we were working with has off-ramps. If the cap does not get raised, there are off-ramps would allow us to step back, look at possibly renegotiating, possibly coming up with, you know, if Amarath could come back to us and say, okay, with no net metering, here's the price we can give you. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know if the city would go for it or not, but we would have to
see.
Right.
Okay,
yeah.
Great. Thank
you. No, I'm good, because I answered the question.
Councilor Klein.
I'd like to say thank you as well. I think this is an incredible boon to our community. In terms of size, one of the things I heard at the meeting the other night is that this is going to be the largest of the solar arrays that Amarisco is working on. I think we're going to be the sixth city, and they've only done arrays up to 3 kilowatts, and this one, or megawatts, I'm sorry, and ours is going to be 3.3, right?
Right. On landfills.
On landfills, yes.
I don't remember, but I would be surprised if they haven't built larger arrays on ground mounts someplace.
Right. So,
I can't guarantee that. But on landfill, yes, this would be the largest array that they put on a landfill so far.
And
yes.
They've put these arrays on landfills for cities that are larger than ours, and they've been small. The arrays have been mm-hmm. smaller, so it's really wonderful. The number that stood out to me as most impressive is that we are actually offsetting 2,931 tons of CO2 with this array, and that's just an incredible thing for the public health and the benefit of the city. So thank you.
Any more questions?
One more. Wouldn't that be equivalent to like over 600 houses that would serve?
You know,
somewhere.
It's in here. They had it. There we go. They had it in their handouts. So they said it was equivalent to taking 617 passenger vehicles off the road for 1 year. Wait a minute. What is this? Okay, 11. I'm trying to look for their stats, because they did all the calculations. They're taking them over 20 years, it'd be like taking almost 12,000 cars off the road, carbon sequestered by about 46,000 acres of forest over the 21 years. So I don't see the number of households.
I thought that I read that on one of the papers that they gave us. Okay.
So any other questions in finance? All in favor of a positive recommendation to the council?
Aye.
Say aye. Aye. Any no aye? Everybody's good?
No aye. Nicely put.
No aye. So, and that's the end of our finance agenda. So, there's no other unsuspected business. So, a motion to adjourn would be in order.
Move to adjourn.
Second?
Second.
We come out of recess and we go back into the regular meeting. And we start with, excuse me, second reading for the financial order to reprogram funds for Jackson Street School stair repair project.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion on this item? And roll call, please.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor
Rivera.
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
That's approved in second reading and approved final. We also have the financial order to authorize payment for the prior year bill for city uniforms. This is second reading
Move
as well.
To approve.
Motions are made. Is there second? Second. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Yes.
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 Yes. That also passes in second reading. Now, we have the order regarding the landfill solar array project. I'll waive reading because
I make that motion.
Councilor Murphy has already paid his dues on that. The motion's made. Is there a second?
Second.
I second it.
Any further discussion? Roll call on that, please.
Councilor
Labarge.
Yes. Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor
O'Donnell. Yes.
Councilor Sherrill.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
That passes in first reading. We'll be discussing that again on the 15th. Now we have, this is kind of important because not a lot of folks in the city know this, but this is a warrant for the November 3rd, 2015 biennial municipal election. There will be an election. Just to let folks know and hope they participate, that we've had have various projections for really low numbers, and I hope that's not true. So as we go forward with this, I would accept a motion for first reading.
Make a move.
And in fact, actually, I'll read the warrant for you, which is always exciting. And I'll spare you the voting locations. Is that okay, or would everyone like to hear the voting locations? No. This is ordered that the biennial municipal election in the city of Northampton for the choice of municipal officers be held on Tuesday, the third day of November 2015, in several polling places designated by the city council. And those will be posted, but that's for wards 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. The polls will be open at 7 o'clock in the forenoon and close at 8 o'clock in the evening on the on said day. And all such voters will, within the set hours in the wards in which they are individually entitled to vote, given their votes for city clerk for the two ensuing municipal years, for two councilors at large for the two ensuing municipal years, for one councilor from each of the seven wards of the city for the two ensuing municipal years, for two members of the school committee at large for 2 years from the first Monday of January 2016, and for one school committee member from each of the seven wards to serve for 2 years from the first Monday of January 2016, for three superintendents of Smith's Agricultural School to serve for 2 years from the first Monday of January 2016, for one elector under the Oliver Smith will for 2 years from the first Wednesday of May 2016, and for three trustees under the will of Charles E. Forbes for 4 years under the first Monday of January 2016, and for two members at large to the Community Preservation Committee for 4 years from the first Monday of January 2016. Do you want me to read the candidates? No? Councilor Shara?
I'll just note there's some misspellings of names.
Misspellings of names on
names?
The
of
on
candidates.
Of the candidates.
Of candidates.
We can recommend, we can do Scrivener's errors or amendments. Can which names do you?
Well, mine.
yeah. Really? So you're okay, you're gonna be picky about that. Okay.
It's Gina Louise's two words, hyphenated, capital L. And there's some spacing issues, but the other big one I see is Elaine Reel's name is has two L's in the at the end.
Correct. That's correct. Anyone else notice any other spelling errors on this? Okay. Hopefully we'll. Yeah.
Just out of curiosity.
What's that?
Two
well, he's for the his concern is whether the clerk has already submitted the ballot to the state and whether it's too late to correct for the ballot. This is, I assume, a copy of the ballot transcript. I think, is that your question essentially, is whether the clerk is allowed under state law now to make the corrections or not? I don't know.
Yeah,
right. Okay.
So there may still be time, but I would maybe recommend taking two readings tonight or somehow getting word to her that of these changes.
Okay. Right.
I don't know what this is relative to what's been sent to the
right. Board. If this actually reflects the ballot or if it was just a Scrivener's error on the transmission.
The transmission of that information. I don't know. But I know she did indicate that she sent something off to the printer for printing. Once you drew the names, all the names were drawn, words were set, and all that.
There's an additional one, actually. Sorry.
Well, Pam, can we just make a note and send that note of expressed concern by the counselors for these, at least the two spelling errors that we noted?
Also, I believe Mark Warner spells his name with a C, not a K.
Yes, that's right. His first name is spelled.
I'm sorry.
Okay, so first we start with Ward 4. Counselor candidate Gina space Louise Sciarra.
That might not be changed. That might be because of how it's registered, because there's no hyphen.
That may be, but
that
I mean,
that might not be fixable. But the other ones are.
It's reasonable for a space. Elaine Reel, under Forbes Library Trustee, is R-E-A-L-L is her last name, not just R-E-A-L. And then, oh, Jesse, did you get the wrong middle initial? Okay, it's Jesse M, comma Adams, probably not true. Jesse M, period Adams. But I yeah, and.
Counselor. Two members of the school committee at large. Did you mention Carrie?
Nikerchuk?
Yeah, see the initial?
Yeah, there's a space between her first name and the initial. The same seems to have occurred for Edward Zukowski. He got his middle initial blended in, so he's Edwards Zukowski. Those are spacing errors, but probably important.
Just Counselor the record, my name is fine.
Yay.
Noted. So please don't touch Councilor O'Donnell's name.
Please make my God.
Let's see. As we go through, I'm fine.
Kowski, too.
And Mark Warner is spelled M-A-R-C, not M-A-R-K. Maureen Carney's correct. Well, why don't we read everybody now, since we've pretty much gone through everything. If everyone would bear with me. This is a vote for one, Wendy A. Mazza. This is for city clerk. Two councilors at large, you get to vote for not more than two. And this is William H. Dwight, Jesse M. Adams, and Mark G. Warner. The councilor from Ward 1, vote for one, Maureen T. Carney. Councilor from Ward 2, vote for one, Dennis P. Bidwell. Councilor from Ward 3, vote for one, Ryan R. O'Donnell, spelled correctly. Councilor from Ward 4, vote for one, Gina space Louise, starting with a capital L, Sciarra. For Councilor from Ward 5, that would be vote for one, David A. Murphy, apparently spelled all correctly. Councilor from Ward 6, vote for one, Mary Ann L. LaBarge. Councilor from Ward 7, vote for one, Alisa F. Klein. And then two members of the school committee at large, vote for not more than two, Carrie space M. Nikerchuk, Nathaniel M. Reed, and Blue Duvall, and Molly B. Burnham. Member of the school committee from Ward 1, vote for one, Rebecca Busansky. Member of the school committee from Ward 2, that would be Laura Fallon. Member of the school committee from Ward 3, vote for one, Howard T. Moore. Member of the school committee from Ward 4, Edward Space S. Zukowski. Member of the school committee from Ward 5, Ann M. Hennessy. And vote for school committee from Ward 6, vote for one, John B. Wills, Thomas J. Baird. And then a member of the school committee from Ward 7, vote for one, R. Downey Meyer. And then three superintendents of the Smith Agricultural School, vote for not more than three, Thomas M. Fitzgerald, John E. Cotton, Michael T. Cahillane, or depending on who you ask in his family, Cahillane. Elector under the Oliver Smith will, vote for one, David A. Murphy. Three trustees under the will of the Charles E. Forbes, this is the library trustee, vote for not more than three, Peter L. Coble, A. Twarog, and I believe it's Joseph.
Yes, Joseph is, Joseph. It's yeah, at the end
fact,
of the other line.
He's up after the zip code on Peter Coble. That's his first name. Mm-hmm. So we'll just, yeah, it's a little justification error. Janet S. Gross. And actually, Elaine got bumped too, so it's Elaine M. Real, not really. R-E-A-L-I is spelled here, it's R-E-A-L-L. And then Kathleen E. White. And then two committee community preservation at large and vote for not more than two, David Whitehill. And then there is a vacancy, which is spelled correctly.
You know, they did exceptionally well on the Irish names, you'll notice.
I notice.
We all, I think we're batting 100% if you're Irish.
Getting better and better.
Apparently. Or of English heritage as well. All right, so the motion's made and the amendment's made. Councilor Klein.
As we're copy editing, are we in the business of spelling counselor with two L's in Northampton? We've always done it with
one.
No, we are a single L, non-gender specific counselor.
So all of the counselors, everything that says counselor needs to be changed.
We have some documents that actually do list us with two L's. I've seen that happen.
The new charter changed it to one
L. The new charter changed it to one L. Okay, so noted, counselors will be spelled in all cases with one L. Anything else?
Just one more tiny thing.
Okay.
Under Ed Zukowski, 67 Ice Pond is six. There should be a space between 67 and Ice.
I made that correct.
Okay.
You got the, yeah. So it's 67, not 671 C Road Pond Drive. Got it. Good catch. Everyone okay with the font of the tab? Margins, everyone's okay with that?
Could I ask you?
We blue penciled this, yes.
Say, like with Carrie.
Yes.
She lived on Woods Road, but she now lives on Portsmouth Road.
Your address?
I took out my papers as 102 Lake Street.
Right.
My papers say 102 Lake Street when I submitted them. I don't live at 102 Lake Street. I'm on the ballot as 102 Lake Street. That's the way.
That might be based on previous registration. I don't know.
I don't know.
So,
Clerk Mazza pointed out to me, she said, these papers say Lake Street, so it's going to have to say Lake Street on the ballot.
Okay.
Oh, okay. That's what I thought. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
So yes. That's okay. All right. So, as amended, Mayor, I take your point. I think, actually, if we do two readings tonight, and that's entirely up to you, but if we do two tonight as amended, then that allows the clerk to, if the Secretary Galvin's office requires some more specificity relative to this, at least give her that flexibility. Anyway, in first reading, is there any further discussion or further editing of these? So, okay, and did we move this in first reading?
Second. She moved it.
Okay, so the motion. So any further discussion? All those in favor for first reading, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Actually, does this require a roll call? Not to establish a warrant. Okay. All right. Is there a motion to suspend rules?
Suspend Rule 14.
Second.
Any discussion about the suspension of rules? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 I'll entertain a motion.
Second reading.
Motion is made and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Okay. Who knew that was going to take up time? Didn't see that one coming. All right. Next up.
I just want to ask the question, though, if for some reason
in the main, I don't see as it makes any specific problem. It's not like every election will be invalidated for an additional L. So I don't think that's a terrific concern. But
and there's plenty of time for them to change their name between the election and when we get sworn in. So
exactly.
If they have to do that, they just change.
I think it's more important that their name be properly reflected on the ballot, because there is some question of legitimacy of the vote. But if counselors spell with two or one L's, I don't think that's really good. Subject to challenge. So next up we have, this is an order to adopt Mass General Law 71, Section 71E. That's the City Council hereby accepts the provisions under Mass General Laws Chapter 71, Section 71E, which allows monies received by the school committee from the conduct of the adult education and continuing education programs, summer school programs, and community school programs or from the use of school property to be held in separate accounts to be extended by the school committee without further appropriation for the purposes of the program or programs from which the receipts are derived or towards the expense incurred in making the school property available for such uses.
Move to approve.
Second reading has been moved and has been seconded. Any further discussion?
No.
Roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LeBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Now we come to the credit incentive policy for the stormwater flood control as it's been amended and revised. It's the revision from that you heard Ned describe. It's been a motion made. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Discussion on that? Ned spoke to this and it was laid out in the memo that he described the bullet points about the changes of.
Right.
So
we are voting on this because there was nothing here voting on it or not.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Did the Committee on Public Works make a recommendation on it?
No.
Did they?
Yeah, send it forward.
We came forward with it. Yeah, let me double check here.
Oh, yeah, it was in the minutes.
This is the one she warned me about, and this is the one I slept through. So is there a desire to refer this to ordinance?
The only thing I would point out is just that under the ordinance that you wrote, the council, it's a up or down approval that came up when we crafted the ordinance, so it's a yes or no vote.
Right, it's a yes or
no. So it's not like it's an ordinance that right. You send to be edited or to make amendments to. It's really...
So the equivalent of an election.
Okay.
So if you don't like it, you would have to tell the DPW to go back
and revise the revision.
Yeah.
And it's an ongoing thing. It happens every year.
Yeah.
So we're just complying with the stormwater.
But when we drafted the ordinance, I know that was one of the issues that came up. That's
not
the way it's written. That's why it's not written into the ordinance. It's really an administrative agency's policy. But we're asking you to review it and approve it every year.
Okay.
Is there a desire to refer it for discussion in the ordinance? Everyone's okay with that?
Ordinance.
So this will be simply be yay to approve the revisions or not.
Move to approve.
Motion's made.
Second.
Any discussion on this further? We'll do a roll call on this.
Councilor Sherrill.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LeBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
And that passes. So now, an ordinance pertaining to the 24-hour parking came with a positive recommendation from the Committee on Rules, Orders, and Appointments and Ordinances. This was second reading.
Move approval.
Seconded.
Yep.
Any further discussion on this item?
Yep.
Roll call, please.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LeBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill?
Yes.
Now we have also the ordinance pertaining to parking on Prospect Street, also again with a positive recommendation from the Committee on Rules, Orders, Appointments, and Ordinances.
To approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call.
Councilor White?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LeBarge?
Yes.
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 Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
And now we have the ordinance pertaining to parking at the Northampton Senior Center with a positive recommendation from the Committee on Rules, Orders, Appointments, Ordinances as amended. Second reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Yes.
Councilor
Klein? Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes. So that passes in second reading as well. We have the ordinance pertaining to bike lanes on North Elm Street. This was referred to the Committee on Rules, Orders, Appointments, and
Yes, two of them.
So you want to do the other one? Do you want to do them as a whole?
I'd move them as a group.
Okay. That's also the ordinance pertaining to South Street, which is also...
Move to ordinance.
So these are both for referral to ordinance, and there's a motion. Seconded?
Yep.
Okay. Any discussion on the referral? Council Plant.
Just like to say that the bike lanes have already been painted, but we are voting now.
We do. We do need to make the rules in order to justify the painting, but that's true. The bike lanes exist, and they're being well used.
They look very nice.
And they do look very nice. That said, this will be referred for a moot discussion. So any...
And they're proofread, too.
And they're proofread as well.
Margins are all...
Touche. All those in favor of referral, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Are there any updates from the council president? No, there are not. Any committee chairs have updates? Any information requests? I'll accept the motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
Okay, I'm glad we got a second. Not debatable. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you all very much. We'll see you on the 15th.